Start. There we go. So that's me and my title. And do you all know about the Nature Conservancy already? Have you heard of us? You can just kind of nod if your face is there. And we're a big organization. It's one of the largest global nonprofits, started in 1951, although we actually started under a different name well before that. And we now have thousands of employees around the United States and around the world. We're a science-based organization. So over 400 of those scientists are, over 400 of our staff are scientists. And we operate in all of the states in the United States, as well as an additional 70 countries or so. So we've been around for a long time. We've been in Massachusetts for almost 60 years. And so in Massachusetts, the Nature Conservancy, you know, we're focused on making the world a better place, right? That's what we're here for, you know, globally and also in Massachusetts. And what I love about the Nature Conservancy is that we think globally. We do our science at a global scale, but then we touch down locally. And we're always using, you know, innovative science. We're on the cutting edge. And we're always thinking about scaling. So what we do in Massachusetts gets scaled in a couple of ways. One is that we're part of this global network. So what we learned, for example, in Massachusetts about restoring oyster beds and or doing aquaculture in a way that enhances the environment will be used in Indonesia. It'll be used in Australia. It'll be used all around the world. And so that way we can scale impact, and we're looking for long-lasting solutions. You know, there's a lot of conservation groups in Massachusetts that are focused project by project. We're really thinking about systems change, big complex changes. And of course, we need that right now more than ever because, the world needs us. The world needs all of us. So I am going to be talking about nature-based solutions. A nature-based solution, is a solution to a problem. Sometimes it's a social problem or a health problem or a community problem that uses the natural features or processes of nature. So sometimes it's referred to as ecological services to help us adapt to the impacts, in this case of climate change, or to enhance community resilience. So nature-based solutions is when we use nature to help solve another problem. And, you all probably are aware that you can restore a wetland, and it provides lots of different ecological services. It helps clean water. We'll talk about that. I actually have an infographic about wetlands. Natural climate solutions is one kind of nature-based solution. It is a technique that uses nature and natural processes to pull greenhouse gases from the atmosphere and store carbon. And I mean, you can guess what I'm talking about, right? Forests. But what you might not know is even more carbon gets pulled from the atmosphere and sequestered in the ocean. And of course, agriculture land soils have a tremendous opportunity. There's a tremendous opportunity to have ag practices that also help us address climate impacts by holding on to carbon. And so this is the infographic for forests, so you can see all of the ways that forests can help us. These are different kinds of trees, right, that we've got. And in Massachusetts, we actually have them all, right? We've got wildlands. If you go to the western part of the state, we call it the Berkshire linkage, where through the Berkshires, we're linking a connected landscape all the way from the southern Appalachians all the way into the boreal forest in Quebec. There's a linkage that goes through. And so wildlands are often, reserves where they can be managed just naturally without harvesting. And that allows our large trees to stay large and keep growing. And to continue to sequester carbon. So if you think about what trees do, as they're growing, they're taking carbon in, and that's helping build their mass, and it's in their leaves, it's in their trunk, and then they store it in their trunk. And then also the leaves end up storing it in the soils as leaf litter, right? It very slowly will decompose. And so it holds on to a lot of carbon, drawing it from the air, holding it. And of course, when we have these forest fires, it's a quick release of carbon. And it's part of the tragedy of what we're seeing, particularly out west with forest fires. You know, there's many places in Massachusetts where there are woodlands that are being managed for wood products. Historically, the wood products industry has been important in New England and Massachusetts as well. It's gotten less so over the years, in part because of competition from Canada and now China. It's a world market. But, you know, there are, we have many forests in Massachusetts that are still being logged and managed for wood products. And there's a way to do that that is carbon and climate friendly. And so at the Nature Conservancy, we spend some time with owners of family forests to help them understand the ways to manage their woodlots with climate change in mind. And then of course there's urban trees, and urban trees are so important for so many reasons, you know, carbon being one of them. But also one of the things we've discovered, what our science shows, is that areas in cities that have trees are healthier. You have better health outcomes, and folks spend less on their energy bills because it's cooler. It's cooler in the summer, and you know, there's shade. And one of the things we learned from COVID is it's also a healthier place for people to live. You can, you know, communities that have green spaces that are easily accessible end up being healthier for folks because you can go outside safely and spend some time outdoors. And the science increasingly, have you all heard of forest bathing? I would bet this is a group that's probably heard this term before. It came out of a study from Japan, which actually showed specific health outcomes from just being in a forest. You don't even really have to walk. It's not about exercise. It's about the stress levels, and the stress hormones really go down by being in nature. And so when we're thinking about forests, this is a natural climate solution. And let me see if I can get to the next slide. So one of the things, you know, we're talking about this, the protective power of nature, and I won't go into details about this, but this came out of one of our scientific studies that looked at all of the ways that nature can help us achieve our global climate goals. And there's a group called the IPCC, but it's out of the United Nations. It's the science arm of the United Nations that's looking at climate change. And they came out with a study now about 2.5 years ago that showed that the world would not be able to achieve the global goal of reducing climate change, reducing greenhouse gas emissions so that we don't warm over the 1.5 degree centigrade increase, right? That's the goal, right? Is to keep the climate from getting worse, that we're not going to achieve that global goal that came out of the Paris Climate Accord without including nature, without including natural climate solutions. And that almost 30% of our emissions can be addressed through nature. And it's a but-for proposition. If we don't deal with emissions that come from nature and the abilities to sequester, we will not achieve the goal. So on both sides. And you might say, emissions from nature? Have you ever walked by like a bog that really smelled like sulfur? It smelled like rotten eggs? That's because it's grown eutrophic, it's polluted. And so it's no longer doing the right natural processes. And so it's giving off methane gas, which is a very potent greenhouse gas. So as we are losing our salt marshes or our wetlands because of pollution as they're degrading, it's actually causing climate pollution. And as we restore these wetlands, it actually becomes a carbon sink. So there's an opportunity, it's like a twofer, right? It's a, you know, as we invest in restoration of wetlands, restoration of salt marshes, we're stopping climate emissions that are happening, and we're also bringing, sequestering more carbon. We're bringing more into nature that would otherwise be in the environment. So you can see, I don't know how small your screen is, but there we have forests, we've got agricultural lands and grasslands and wetlands is two areas where there's potential for sequestering carbon. And this is only looking at the sequestering side, it's not looking at the emission side because that science is still evolving. Like we only know part of where all of those emissions are coming from, right? So here's the example. I think people can often visualize this with cars. So in the United States, nature has the potential of removing 21% of all the nation's carbon pollution, equivalent to removing emissions from all cars and trucks on the road, and then some. And so you can see from forests, if we're doing everything right with our forests, then it's 145 million cars off the road, improved agriculture, grasslands, coastal habitats. So you can see in this that it really matters. Nature really matters when it comes to solving climate change. What's great about nature is you get a lot of bang for your buck with nature. So when you think about it, with a tree, if you're restoring trees, you know, if you're planting trees and letting trees grow, if you're managing your forest so that you're maximizing the carbon sequestration, there's other really great things that happen as well. Trees actually improve water quality because they prevent erosion. It obviously improves biodiversity because, you know, when we're at the Nature Conservancy, we're looking at two major crises in the world right now, climate change and the die-off, the biodiversity die-off. And so as we're prioritizing our work, we're looking for the intersection. We're looking, every time we're spending money and raising money for big projects, we're looking at how do we address climate change and at the same time protect biodiversity? Like how can we do them both? So trees obviously filter the air, they improve air quality, provide sustainable timber, fiber, and fuel. And as you know, the fuel piece is a little controversial, right? We just saw the Springfield plant being turned down and a new bill proposed, which I absolutely agree with. And just so you know, when you burn wood for electricity, three quarters of the energy in the wood goes out the stack. It's very inefficient. Trees improve soil health. They create rural jobs. And of course the food products and so forth, food and forest products. So trees are like, they're an amazing solution. So I'm shifting a little bit to thinking about biodiversity. So this is a little bit more in the weeds about how we at the Nature Conservancy think about our work. And this is kind of a pretty cool map. And when you see the green shows species migration. So the green shows the path that species will use as they migrate to because of climate change. Like we know it's getting warmer. So, you know, the ranges that species can live change. And, you know, just because you've got a frog that no longer can live in Massachusetts doesn't mean that it can't actually live in New York, Northern New York or Vermont or New Hampshire or Maine. So one of the things that we think about as we're investing in land protection, as we're actually conserving land, is how do we make sure there's a connected landscape of resilient land that can provide habitat for the largest variety of species possible. So this was a really great piece of scientific work that's been used by state governments, local governments, federal government. I mean, it's really a very useful piece of work, and it downscales. So this is looking just at the Appalachian range, and you can see that Massachusetts is right there, right? So we're touching this where my cursor is. So take a look at how we think species are going to migrate. Some are going to go north, some are going to go south. It depends on what the particular species need. Do they need it to be warm? Do they need it to be cold, cooler? And so our focus in this Massachusetts area is on all those little green spots. And I could have one more slide that really focuses in deeply onto the Massachusetts. But what's wonderful about what we've been able to do here in Massachusetts is our map is used by all of our partner organizations. So the Berkshire Land Trust, the trustees, the Audubon, and the state all use this science to help prioritize their conservation. We're all on the same page. It's such a wonderful community of conservation, you know, organizations. And very slowly we are filling in those green spaces so that we will have climate resilience and we'll protect as many species, as much biodiversity as possible. Because we know the climate is changing and we just don't know how fast or, you know, kind of what the pace is. And so we just want to make sure that the most variety of species will be able to survive and thrive by being able to migrate. The last thing I want to talk about is like thriving people, because, you know, obviously we're part of nature ourselves. And so that's really the climate resilience and the climate adaptation side of the coin. So we were just talking about climate change and how nature can help us solve the problem by sequestering carbon, pulling carbon from the air. And as we restore like degraded wetlands or replant trees, we can supercharge that. And then we talked about how nature does multiple things at once. So those trees aren't just protecting us from climate change, they're providing a lot of other ecological services. And so that's what we're going to talk about is how nature also can protect us from the impacts of climate change. And so this is a fun little infographic, and I don't know how, depending on your screen size, it might be hard to see this all, but this shows the varied landscape. So you've got, you know, some urban, rural, you've got the mountains, you've got the wetlands, and in this infographic, it talks about wetlands here. Restoring wetlands supports plants and animals, filters pollution from water sources. They're magic. They also protect us from floods. When I was secretary in Vermont, during Tropical Storm Irene, it just destroyed roads and bridges and all of our major towns in most of the, it actually destroyed roads and bridges in 225 of our 250 towns in Vermont. And so that's a lot. And one of the towns that got off almost scot-free was the town of Middlebury. I don't know if any of you have ever been there. It's a gorgeous spot. It's where Middlebury College is, where my daughter went. It's a really a sweet spot. And so we wanted to know like why the Otter Creek went right through Middlebury, went south of Middlebury, it destroyed Brandon, which is the big town south of Middlebury, completely wiped out the whole downtown intersection, bridges gone, roads gone, buildings gone. And by the time it got to Middlebury though, it was, you know, it was above flood level, but it didn't destroy infrastructure. And we looked and we discovered that between Brandon and Middlebury, there was a series of wetlands, of bogs, that had been protected, conserved by the conservation organizations in Vermont. And it acted like a sponge. And as all that water was rushing up the stream and more water was joining it, instead of getting even stronger, it dissipated because of these wetlands. And somebody did the math and found that just in that one flood alone, it saved, I don't know if it was $1.7 million in infrastructure that wasn't damaged from that that wetland preservation. Now, you should know the wetland was not being protected because of flooding. Nobody was thinking about flooding when they protected that wetland. They were thinking about the flyway. It would happen to be a place that the snow geese would come on their flights, and plus many other birds. So it was actually protected using duck stamp money, which is you know, when folks go hunting and they have to buy a permit to go hunting for ducks and geese, for waterfowl, you pay money and that goes to protecting more wetlands. And so that was duck stamp protection that ended up saving the town of Middlebury. And in Massachusetts, we've seen this too. We're actually working on a really interesting project in East Boston to restore the Belle Isle Marsh. And this is a coastal marsh, it's a salt marsh, and it's degraded. So it's polluting, and it's really problematic, and it's in an area of the city where there's not a lot of great green spaces for people to go out in. And so we're restoring this marsh. We're putting in systems that'll help clean up the pollution. And so when it's clean, it'll be a great place because it's an estuary. It's where all of the birds come, and the fish, you know, the fish in the ocean start in the salt marshes. It'll be really an asset to the community. It'll also be a great place for people to come and take a walk outdoors. Plus, it'll provide protection from coastal flooding and from sea level rise, because that's, of course, in Massachusetts, going to be a big deal. Not where you live, but for a lot of the population in Massachusetts who live near the coast, sea level rise is significant. So, you know, you can see there's lots of different ways that natural infrastructure can help clean water and also provide other important ecological services. So this is the wetlands absorb excess nutrients, sediment, and pollution before they reach rivers, lakes, and streams. And wetlands provide space for floods, absorbing flood water and slowly releasing them, reducing the impact of flooding events or on downstream communities. So one of the great programs we have in Massachusetts is the MVP program. It's called the Municipal Vulnerability Program. And this is something that actually Katie Thea Herides, who's the Secretary of the Environment in Massachusetts, it's one of her projects from before she was secretary. And it is a collaboration between a number of organizations, ours as well as Mass Audubon and the state government. And it provides grants to communities to help communities plan for climate change, to think about, okay, how are we vulnerable to climate change? And then there was 150 towns, cities in Massachusetts that received these planning grants, and they, you know, had a community process for identifying, priorities for responding to climate change. And this was all came out of some work from the Nature Conservancy. And then we went further and we provided implementation grants for a number of communities. And some of these examples are in Salem, they put in place a living shoreline. Newbury assessed the salt marshes. And you can see there, we've done a bunch of things. Most recently, we have a project in Holyoke, where we're helping folks in that community prioritize a whole suite of activities to build resilience in their communities. And, you know, this MVP program doesn't just focus on nature-based solutions, but also sometimes hardened infrastructures needed as well. But they put a premium on nature-based solutions. And that's because, you know, if you build a culvert, that's great. You've got a good culvert. But if you restore a wetland, in addition to having the benefits of the wetland for water quality and floods, You also have a great green space. It improves your quality of life. So it provides multiple benefits. So there's a priority for using nature to address resilience. And let's see. Finally, access to nature matters. As I mentioned earlier, we've learned this during COVID that there are differences in health outcomes. For those of us who are blessed to be in places where we can go outside and take walks and experience nature, it was a very different experience than for folks who've had to suffer through this pandemic, you know, in an apartment and away from nature. So I will take questions. And here's how you can help. You can learn more about our work at nature.org. Of course, we love to get donations, and you can follow us on social media. We've got lots of fun things going on. We have lots of presentations and so forth. We have a whole webinar series. So the question is, are we funded through the state and other sources? So 80% of the funding from the Nature Conservancy comes from individuals who are donors. And we are blessed with a lot of supporters all over the world. And actually, most of our supporters, most of our financial supporters comes from donors from the United States, which actually supports our work all over the world. We do get some government grants. That you may have followed that one of the great accomplishments of Congress in the last term was passing the Land and Water Conservation Fund and funding it, fully funding it for the first time in my memory. And that's money that comes from the federal government, often to the state, that's then directed towards land conservation and parks and agriculture, all sorts of projects. And so that Land and Water Conservation Fund is some of the money that is used to help with some of our conservation projects. By and large, though, right now, when we're doing conservation projects where land is being purchased and owned, we end up not being the owners. So we often act as a catalyst, putting together deals where the land will ultimately be in the ownership of the state in the long term. What we think about is who is how best the land would be managed over time. And so, you know, we do have areas where we've got our own preserves, and if we conserve land that's contiguous to our preserve, we'll often keep that in our ownership because it'll allow us to manage the preserve as a whole. We've got another question. Do we deal directly with individuals with forest management? We actually right now have a program called the Family Forest Program. We received some great grant funding, some of it from Amazon, of all places, who is helping to support work with private landowners, families who own land. And in Massachusetts, the vast majority of forest land are owned by people, families, just like you and me, who just happen to own a parcel of land that's forest. So we've got a woman who lives up in Northampton, actually, who works with these family forest owners to help them manage their forests for carbon. Yeah, amongst other things, right? It's also biodiversity. In some cases, they're also logging some of it. They're taking out some of the lumber so they could pay taxes. But there are ways to manage your forest land to maximize carbon benefit. And so we're just putting together a handbook that's going to be used as part of the training. And feel free if you have your own, if you've got a lot of forested land and want information, just, you know, feel free to reach out and I'll get you on the list so you can get notified when that publication is out. So what nature-based solutions are most commonly used in non-shoreline communities? I would say that nature-based solutions are not so different in shoreline and non-shoreline communities. So restoring wetlands is really important when you're thinking about flood resilience, when you're, you know, thinking about floods from rivers. Planting trees is really important, again, when you want to protect a community from floods, because it prevents erosion, it holds, it softens the rain, so it doesn't create an erosive flood that's going to sort of wipe out roads. It slows the water down. And putting green spaces in important places. So in a place that if you've got a river through your town, which you do, you want to, where you can, reconnect the river to the flood, for to its floodplain, so that it can overfill its banks. Like, you know, if you think about most of the rivers in Massachusetts, with the exception of Western Mass, where there's a little bit more open space, most of those rivers have been straightened and they've been armored in some way because you're going through town. And so it means that the water gets really fast. So if it rains, the water comes in, and you've probably seen it after a rainfall or after snowmelt, how fast the water goes. And that creates a lot of erosion, which does a couple of things. One is it pours pollution into ultimately into the ocean, and because it's eroding the sides of the riverbanks, which have phosphorus and nitrogen and all sorts of things in it, and so it creates nutrient pollution that's problematic, and then it also creates therefore a flooding risk, because as you have an erosion, then the trees come down and the water overfills, and so slowing down that water by having places for the water to naturally overflow so it can slow down is really key. So that's something, you know, we've done a lot of taking out of dams also. There was a lot of dams put into our rivers over the years, and it's problematic, obviously, for the fish. We know about that, but it also creates this flooding, these flooding problems. So that's another thing that can be done. Urban trees are really important. The more we put trees back into our urban spaces, the better off we'll be as communities. So I see somebody said some Framingham High School students, are planting trees in yards for a small contribution. What can we do to increase students' awareness, knowledge of our city's nature, stewardship history, and actually do something in partnership with parents and teachers? Well, I think it's wonderful that they're doing this work. And I would suggest that you reach out through the high school to try to connect them with others who are interested in their work. Really, that's really exciting to know that they're taking it on themselves. Now, you know, there's a lot to know about planting trees. You know, it's if the tree's going to live, you don't just take, you know, you don't just dig out, you know, a two-year-old, you know, tree and plant it somewhere new and have that necessarily be successful. So it wouldn't hurt to have somebody with some expertise come in. Do we work combating invasive species to restore healthier chance for native species? We do. So we've got our, you know, in our own properties, that's always part of our management plan, is to think about invasive species so that our native species will have a better chance. Right now, the woman who's the head of our stewardship program is starting to think about climate change, because there's some invasive species that have just, like, they've come over from somebody's garden, like somebody, they really, it's a species that's come from Asia or Europe or somewhere else, and it's out competing. In some cases, it's a migration of species because of climate change. Like, there are some species that are coming in that will succeed more because the weather has changed and the ecosystems are changing. And so, as we're thinking about removing invasives, like honeysuckle, who knew? But honeysuckle, you know, which I used to love as a kid, it turns out it's evil and invasive, and it's even really bad for the birds because they love it, and it's like eating sugar all day. It has no nutrition for them, but so, you know, pulling out the honeysuckle, for example, or the buckthorn. There's lots of things. And but there's other things that then when we plant, we need to be forward thinking, like what's going to thrive in 30 years? You know, what do we want to be ready for? So yes, invasives are problematic, and it feels like an endless fight. So thank you all for doing your part with your own gardens and really asking before you buy plants for your gardens to make sure they're native, because that's where a lot of these problems have happened over the years. Says as a homeowner who's had lots of sticks in my yard, is it better to make piles of sticks or burn them? We're allowed open burning in my town. And so it depends on where you are. So I would say if you're in a place that is really wooded, leaving sticks on the ground is the best thing. It creates habitat for critters. If you're in a suburban area though, where you don't have wild spots in your yard, then it brings critters that you might not want. So making piles is what I would generally recommend. Burning it puts the carbon back in the air pretty quickly. On the other hand, sitting around a fire is really lovely. So if you've got one of those little outdoor fire pits, burning some sticks, having some marshmallows, not such a bad thing. Can I say more about Meatless Mondays? How is it being promoted? And what would its effect be on climate change? Yeah, Meatless Monday is really, it's a small thing that can make a real difference. And I don't have this statistic on me. Let's see if I can remember it. I don't want to say a number and then be and find that I'm way off. But meatless, meat is, when we think about all of our, as we live, what our contributions are to climate change. And as they think about, so first of all, when you look at Massachusetts, the biggest contribution to climate change comes from transportation. Now, this crazy pandemic year, maybe it'll look differently because we really didn't drive very far, most of us. But in a normal year, it's all of those car rides that we do, on our own. And so if you're thinking personally about what you can do, it's to think about, driving less and driving alone less, having somebody in the car with you, carpooling, taking public transportation, walking, biking, all of those other options. So driving less is really good. And when you're ready to get a new car, think about a car that's hybrid or electric. And I'm somebody who's had an electric car, and they're really fun to drive. But again, takes a lot of carbon to make a car, so don't buy a new car that you don't need. Food, how we eat is about, I think it's about 22% of emissions, and that's significant. So it's how we grow food, where it comes from. It's surprisingly rice, commercial rice, is, rice patties, how you see the pictures of people knee deep in the water. Rice doesn't actually naturally necessarily have to grow in water like that. The industrial farms grow rice in water because it's a way to keep pests away from the rice. So you don't get rodents because they're not going to swim to eat the grains. And it ends up also being eutrophic, meaning that there's no oxygen, so it gives off methane. And so depending on how you're growing your rice, it's actually almost as bad as meat, but truly it is red meat, it's cows. So it's dairy and red meat that cause the most climate pollution because of the methane gas that comes from the cows. And so Meatless Monday, one day a week is a good contribution. And if the whole world did it, it would make a really big difference. If you did it more than one day, you'll find once you start doing a Meatless Monday, you'll realize just how easy it is to have a lot of meatless days. And in fact, after I went to the climate summit, and it was actually the second one was in Morocco, where they really focused on the role of food in climate change. I actually now I'll eat red meat once a month as a treat, and I still like it. I'm a carnivore, but it's a treat now rather than an everyday thing. And But everyone, each one of you, you have to make your own decisions about where you want to contribute. And for me, that was a way I've done it. One of the interesting things, there's an organization that you should take the statistic, eating one less burger per week is equivalent to driving your car 320 miles less a year. So that's one burger a week. That's amazing. That can be meaningful. There's a lot of scientists who are working on all this. There's an organization called Project Drawdown, which is a project that brings together lots of innovative science around the world. And they actually just discovered an interesting thing about cows and methane, which is that they have known that over time, cows' digestion has become less efficient. And so the cows are producing more methane than they did 100 years ago. And they discovered just by chance that adding seaweed to the feed of cows drastically reduces the methane. And they discovered this from some Welsh cows who were kind of free range and would walk down the beach and kind of eat what was there. And they discovered that their milk became much more efficient milkers, and meaning that they were producing a lot more milk for their feed. And so they started studying them, and they discovered, wow, they're also not emitting methane. And so they actually just finished the study and announced it, where they did, you know, an actual study to see whether or not it was seaweed and if it could be replicated other places. And so who knows? But also, we should just be consuming less, buying less new stuff. And, you know, I know I've got 20-somethings, and their favorite place to shop are the used clothes stores. I think it makes a huge difference. And I couldn't find this quantified anywhere, but the less we're buying, we're consuming new, and the more we're fixing the old stuff, or we're buying used, trading, you know, we've got, a listserv where I live, where people say, I have this old blah, 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 anyone need it? It really that adds up as well and makes a difference. I mean, one of the reasons why in the United States we're responsible for so much of the world's carbon is because we just consume so much, we buy so much stuff. And, so I think less stuff.
So I'm Amy Pawelka from Energize Framingham, just here to chat with you quickly about the resources that we have for everyone here in Framingham. So we have energizeframingham.org is an online resource where you can find different actions and information on how to take those actions to reduce your climate impact. So all the choices that we had on the survey, you can find more information about framinghamsaves.org for energy efficiency. You can find more information about Meatless Monday, planting native species, enough information to get you started and going. And you can find a community of people that are willing to share their experiences with the reviews and just say, hey, I had a great experience with insulating my home or driving an EV or a particular vendor or not. And then you can join like-minded people on teams or even start a team. We have had, Energize Framingham has had the fortune of working with a number of high school interns from the Framingham High School Environmental Club. So those students made their own team on our website and then were able to track their own actions. And I will say we've tried to make an action or opportunities for everyone. So whether you're a renter, a homeowner, a retiree, you should be able to find something there for you. And I want to emphasize, I saw about 28% of people wanted to sign up with Framingham Saves. And this is a specific partnership that the City of Framingham is doing, working with the Mass Save Energy Efficiency Program and a nonprofit called All In Energy, as well as Energize Framingham and SMOC. And it's to bring energy efficiency services to our residents in a way that's accessible to our residents. So you can see there's now services in three languages, English, Spanish, and Portuguese. And also there's a call-in center for all in energy or online appointment making, just trying to make the process easier and have people for you to talk to. I recently saw participation data from Framingham itself, and it seemed that between 40 and 80% of your neighbors have not yet participated in the MassSave program. And everyone that pays an electric bill pays for this program. So I urge you to talk to your friends, talk to people who rent. They are eligible for LED light bulbs to be shipped right to their door. And check out framinghamsaves.org and energizeframingham.org as well.